cover crops out of the way. And one of the things I should have added over here when I was giving you this outline is we're going through this matter of nitrogen, potassium, zinc, and boron. And then below that, we want to go into diagnosis or diagnostic techniques for determining whether or not you have a deficiency. And then you might say areas or situations in which it's likely to occur, areas likely to occur, and then finally treatment. So along, after all this business about organic matter and manure and so forth, we still want to go into this matter on nitrogen and diagnostic techniques. And some of you know that this has been my main field of work, not only in working with mineral nutrition, but trying to work out diagnostic techniques, that is, how to predict whether or not you do need a fertilizer applied, and then going on with a treatment which would give you the recovery. And when I came on this job a number of years ago, it had already been set up that the work was working on. The work had been set up to work with this being a spur and this being the shoot, and once again this being the leaves coming out in this fashion. It had already been determined pretty well that with the clusters, I told you that the grapevine has a very regular fruiting habit, and we worked out to use the petiole of this leaf blade opposite one of those clusters when these clusters were in bloom. And then not to analyze for nitrogen, but to analyze for nitrate. So nitrate in the petiole tissue taken when the clusters are in bloom was the initial, and for many, and up until very recently, has been the main diagnostic technique we've used for predicting nitrogen response. And after calibrating this nitrate in the bloom time petiole over a great number of experiments and so on over the up and down the state, for Thompson seedless, at least, we came up that for just Thompson seedless for raisins or wine, we felt that something in the neighborhood of 0.25% nitrate, not parts per million or anything, but percent nitrate, dry weight, was quite sufficient for proper growth of Thompson seedless used for wine or raisin. For table fruit, particularly in the Coachella Valley, we just about had to modify that to say that you still want, no matter what the nitrate shows, you've got to have enough nitrogen there to give you proper shade effect on the fruit to prevent sunburn. And in some cases, this might raise your nitrate up to as high as 0.5% or even up to 0.75%. But not to the sort of thing that you might get where many of these Coachella Valley growers, some of them, I have measured petiole nitrate up as high as 3%. And I'll show you some pictures in a moment to show you how detrimental that is to grape culture. Many of those Coachella Valley growers, they're not growers. Many of them are not growers. They're retired doctors and MDs and lawyers and movie stars and so on who are using the vineyard as a tax write-off, so I don't really care if they lose money or not. They don't either. But sometimes some of those people are rather stubborn. I went to one vineyard with a farm advisor once where the nitrogen situation, which I was showing you in a moment, was so terrible that he was losing about 2/3 of his crop because of excess nitrogen. And we went up to his house to tell him about it. He sat there very politely and listened to us. And then when we got through, he got up and waddled across the room to his desk and picked up a letter from a fertilizer company or one of these fly-by-night outfits that had analyzed his soil and had recommended he put on 50 pounds of nitrogen right away, fast. And he said, "And I'm going to do it because I paid that guy $50 for this analysis. And there's no point paying him for it if I don't do what he says." And I said, "Well, okay." See, that's what happens when the university gives free advice. Nobody pays attention to it. So anyway, he was already to an extreme excess nitrogen. practically wiping out his crop. But he was going out to apply more nitrogen because these fellows told him to. And that's, and that particular business, by the way, was a business that would contract to take care of your nitrogen recommendations. They would tell you whether or not you needed nitrogen. And they took one-inch soil core for 20 acres once a month. And they analyzed that soil to tell you whether or not you need nitrogen. Of course, they never carried on an experiment to see, to try to correlate soil nitrogen with vineyard response at all, which becomes extremely expensive because it's extremely expensive university where we use these petiole nitrates, where you can take 100 in 5-10 minutes. But to take an adequate soil sample would take, on a 20-acre block, you'd have to put down at least 5 holes per acre and make all sorts of depth composites and what have you, because you got a grapevine here and you got 10% of its roots up here and you got 50% of them down here and you got 10% of them down here. If you're going to analyze the soil properly, then you've got to take 10% of your samples down to this depth, 50% of them down to this depth, and another 10% of them down to this depth, and take this as a composite, and this as a composite, and this as a composite. And then you've got to carry on some fertilizer trials to see whether or not those levels which you find are sufficient or not. And these outfits will analyze your soil and tell you that you need nitrogen, you need phosphorus, you need potassium. I tell people that a soil analysis is worth just about the price of that piece of paper, even without the writing on it, unless they have calibrated it with some fertilizer trials. And none of them have. So they say, sure, they can say it's high, low, and medium. This guy is high compared to this guy. Does that mean that he's deficient? And this guy's low compared to you. Does that mean you're really deficient? That's all they can tell you. All they can tell you is that it's high, low, and medium compared to the samples that they've analyzed. But that doesn't mean that they're deficient. It just means that they have to be low. Low in regard to what? Low in regard to another sample they took. But not low in regard to any tests they ran. And the data isn't worth a thing unless you run some tests. So don't any of you guys send me in some soil analyses after you leave here and ask me to interpret them, because I get them about every 2 weeks. I get a soil analysis from somebody that they spent about $150 having it analyzed, and they want me to interpret it. Well, I don't even know if they took the samples in such a complicated fashion as this or not, but I do happen to know a few of them. They just went out and stopped the car, walked about 50 feet out in the vineyard and put the shovel down and got a bag of dirt and put it the car and brought it over and wanted me to analyze it and tell them whether or not they should buy that land. And that's from one of the better known wineries in Napa Valley.
Is there an outfit that does petiole sampling?
Yes, you can get, we have quite a list of companies that do analyses, and some are better than others, and we're right now involved statewide in a project to try to get them all on the same methods and everything else to try to be sure that we've got, whether it's we're analyzing alfalfa or grapes or what have you, to get around to this. But anyway, so getting back to this, and we use this nitrate, and it worked out pretty well on Thompson, and Thompson makes up about over half the vineyards of the state, so we felt pretty safe on that. But then we found out that there's a terrific difference in varieties in this nitrate. And out here in Leiter's 105 class, or almost now, in an area where you might have 50 varieties in a half acre, you can get nitrates ranging from a tenth of a percent up to over 1%, just among the varieties. No fertilizer applied, no nothing. So that threw a boomerang at us. Then we found out that rootstocks has a similar effect, because you can have St. George rootstock that puts a real high amount of nitrate in the tissue, and another rootstock, 99R or 1613 and some of these others, that put a very low amount, even in the same variety, all on different rootstocks. Well, this thing began to get complicated. So we finally gotten around to some further possibilities of using the total amino acids and instead of using nitrate to use amino acid content in the harvest time juice, amino acid in the harvest time juice. And this work is the result, is built on some work that Dr. Cleaver started out with, and you never know where some of this is going to lead, but he found that in the grape plant that most of the nitrogen, reserved nitrogen in the form of amino acids, and that one of the most important acids was, and the reason I'm hesitating, was arginine. And it looks like that we're off to a real promising new lead on a diagnostic technique by using the arginine in the harvest time juice. And last year was one of our first years of collecting lots of samples, and Dr. Cleaver's taking the lead in this. We're going to do a lot of work in the coming few years to check out arginine and harvest time juice as a possibility of determining a nitrogen sufficiency and so on. And at the moment, just at the moment, if you consider yield against arginine and you get a curve something like this, and the breaking point comes here at around 300 to 400, and that's really parts per million. You put micrograms, so it's really parts per million of arginine in the juice. That may be the breaking point, and we have put a question mark here. Certainly that's true for Thompson seedless, but we may have some variety problems in this case too. So at the moment, we cannot use visual symptoms for nitrogen deficiency on grapes, because the grape just does not show much visual symptom of nitrogen deficiency until it is quite into the red, you might say, into the money-losing column. On nitrogen supply. So we have to go to some diagnostic technique. You can take sugar beets or tomatoes or something like this, and you cut off the nitrogen 10 feet before you get to the end of the row, and you can see it next year when you go out there to shoot your pheasants. You can see right where you stop the nitrogen. But you can't tell it on grapes until you're already suffering quite a loss. So we have to go to some sort of chemical or analysis to find out whether or not we have deficiency. On the other hand, you can go to toxicity. In general, in California at least, we probably have as many vineyards that suffer from excess nitrogen as we do that suffer from lack of nitrogen. In each case, roughly my surveys have indicated that about 20% of the vineyards need nitrogen more than they're getting, but about 20% of them are probably being excessively fertilized. Well, so much for that. Let's look at a few slides, and then I'll wind up this thing with the part that some of you wonder when I'm going to get to. Let's look at a few slides. I don't think we need to close that. This is a mountainside shot of Luis Martinez Monte Rossi vineyards between Napa Valley and Sonoma Valley up on top of the mountain. And he practices fertilizing in alternate middles each year. It's easy to put it on. And he puts on some barley with it and puts on about 40 pounds of nitrogen as urea each year. And this has worked out to be a pretty good program for him. 40 pounds of nitrogen as urea. I'll give you some of these recommendations in a moment. And that works out pretty well. Let's see the next slide. This is a San Joaquin Valley picture. If you can sharpen it just a little bit, Mark. And it's an old muscat vineyard. And Mark, in case you want to know, this is on the way out to Reel2 from Highway 99 out to Reel2, the one on the north side, and you see these old muscat head train vineyards with nitrogen applied in the middle, and rather a natural cover crop. Now, when I was talking about cover crop, I was emphasizing the non-practicality of planting a cover crop. Certainly, I didn't mean that you had to keep it completely weed-free from a natural cover crop. This is a natural cover crop with nitrogen applied here in the middle. And you see the effect of nitrogen on the cover crop, and yet the chances are that these vines don't respond to that nitrogen. The cover crop does, but they don't. But they may there, but I'll show you some in a moment where I know the results. Next slide. This is one of mine over in Napa Valley, where I put it on by hand. You can see where I stopped in the plots over here. Even though the cover crop responds this nicely to nitrogen, these vines didn't show any response at all. The grapevine does not need much in the way of nutrition, especially nitrogen. It's one of the lesser fertilizer demanding tree crops or perennial crops that we have. So just because the weeds respond doesn't mean that, see how dead they were out in here. That's from lack of nitrogen. Given this much nitrogen, the grass responds nicely, but it was not deficient enough for the vines to need it. Next slide. And here are some of the effects of excess nitrogen. I said that sometimes you can put on too much. These are tokay clusters taken from those gravel tanks out by the Winkler vine. And this is the very low nitrogen with tokay. You see the nice, beautiful color, which is what you want to buy when you go to the store. You can up the nitrogen, increase the yield quite a bit, but you retard the color development. This may be 50% more crop than this. But if you're selling it for table fruit, you can't sell this, so why have 50% more crop? Except that the thing to do, which many of the growers are doing, and one other thing that's leading to the decline of the table grape industry in the Lodi area with tokay industry, is that people are saying, well, I'm not going to mess around with growing 6 or 8 tons of table fruit and fight the union and all this business to get it picked and what have you. I'm just going to go hog wild, put on lots of nitrogen, grow 12, 15 tons of grapes and send them to the winery. So more and more of the tokay grapes in Lodi are going to the winery. Less and less are being shipped as table fruit. Not just because of nitrogen, but this is one of the effects. Okay, that's a bad effect of excess nitrogen. Here's another bad effect of excess nitrogen in what we refer to as blind buds. And this is from Coachella Valley, where I tell you a lot of those doctors, lawyers, movie stars, and so forth figure that if 100 pounds of nitrogen is good, 300 pounds ought to be better. And they put on lots of nitrogen, lots of water. They get this very vigorous, flat type of growth. You get buds develop like this that don't develop well enough to push. And therefore, you have what we refer to as blind buds. And then a further condition of this is that quite often, you'll get berries falling off, or flowers falling off of these clusters before they bloom, so that you get a very straggly, poor set from excessive nitrogen. The next slide. And this now is an experiment down at our experiment station at Kearney, where I was talking about the water evaporating 1/10 of an inch per hour. And this is Malbec, an extremely sensitive variety so far as nitrogen is concerned. It's not an important variety in California. It's the most important quality variety in Argentina. And by the way, if any of you read the book textbook carefully enough, Winkler says that Malbec's the most important variety in Argentina. That's a misstatement. About less than 5% of the grapes in Argentina are Malbec. It's the most important quality variety in Argentina. That's what he should have said. But anyway, Malbec is sort of like a Cabernet. 1613 is a low nitrate rootstock type. I told you before that some rootstocks show low nitrate, some show high, and you see quite a good set here on it. But now, right in the next 4 vines down, less than the width of this room, we had Malbec on St. George. And St. George, we've missed this here, but St. George rootstock is a high nitrate type. No fertilizer applied at all because there happened to be high nitrate in the water. And in that area in a hard pan, which held the nitrate. And you see what happened to the crop? I said that it shatters off. This particular 4-vine plot ran nearly 5% in nitrate and averaged just about 5 berries per vine. And I mean about 5 berries at harvest time per vine from excessively high nitrate. So you see, you can get some detrimental effects. Now, Malbec happens to be apparently the most sensitive variety we have in this regard, but it can show you the general effect that you can get. I have made the mistake myself of going out and putting on nitrogen and putting on too much because I put it on by hand, and I'll illustrate this in a moment on the board, and cause some shattering of the clusters. So you can overdo it. Okay, next slide. Now, this was some of our early work on petiole nitrate. And you see, here's the relative nitrate levels of different varieties here at Davis. in this student variety collection I was telling you about. And Grenache happens to be a high type with 0.65, but you can go down to Ribiere, which happens to be an extremely low type of 0.06, all within an area not as close together as, say, four times the size of this room.
Are they all on the same rootstock?
All on their own roots. In this case, all on their own roots, a good point. But fortunately, it isn't quite so bad as that, because Thompson seedless here, which we have most of our data for, is 0.27, and Zinfandel, and Emperor, and Carignan, and Tokay are the next most important group of varieties. So, and this was a number of years ago with the varieties they had listed then, and you see if you pull all those together, you've got probably 30%, about 60% of the acreage in California at that time that you could all use the 0.25 value roughly as a criterion if you wanted to. Okay, next slide. And this was just the general summary of our results in which fertilizer plots up and down the state, in which if the dot fell right on the line, it meant that you got no response at all. The fertilized plots were just the same yield as the non-fertilized plots. But if they moved this way, this far, they got a 10% yield increase from the fertilizer. On the other hand, if the native level to start with, this is the original level of nitrate in the tissue, was already up around 0.3, or I said 0.25 was a good breaking point. If you had it up around 0.4 tenths already and then put on fertilizer, often as not, you reduce the yield as much as frequently as you increase the yield. And it went off the scale up there, of course. The higher you went, the more and more you got decreases in yield. You were wasting the cost of the fertilizer as well as losing crop if you did not need it to start with. Next slide. And this is a slide by Dr. Cleaver on some of our, this is not the overall summary. We've got plots in which, this trial in which we have 80 plots, but this happens to be the 16 which are under a low nitrogen regime. And you can see here that we get, in this case, almost a straight line relationship with a correlation, if you know statistics, of 0.81, which is extremely high, between the concentration of arginine in the juice and the crop yield. And if I should have gotten the slide from Dr. Cleaver with the 80, and you would have seen more or less this typical yield fertilizer curve out of the 80. So this looks very promising as a method. Okay, next slide, or is there one? Okay, may I have the lights, please? Okay, so that's the way we're going on the way of diagnosis. And areas in which it's likely to occur, about all we can say is that it's likely to occur on very sandy soils or quite shallow soils, especially with high-yielding varieties. Shallow soils, very sandy soils with high-yielding varieties. But now treatment. I said that I think one of the real problems with some of the early work that was done with nitrogen fertilizer in the state was going to rates that were too high. Much of the early work was following the old rule of thumb of California tree crops that 100 pounds per acre of nitrogen per year is a good rate. And while I'm talking about that, I might just throw in one other point, is this term of the word, this use of the word unit of nitrogen. You'll find if you go out, as some of you might do and get jobs, that you'll talk about 100 units or so many units of nitrogen per acre. That's a wrong use of the term, because a unit of nitrogen is a specific thing, like a knot is with regard to seamanship or to sailing or to speed. A unit of nitrogen in the language of the language of the fertilizer industry is 20 pounds of nitrogen per ton. It has nothing to do with what you think it does when you say 100 units of nitrogen per acre. If you put 100 units of nitrogen per acre, you put 2,000 pounds of nitrogen per acre. But those of us who are used to farmers' terminology realize what they're talking about, even though they don't know what they're talking about in regard to this word unit. So that's just a little bit of aside. In other words, just remember that if you want to be correct, be safe, and always refer to pounds per acre. And don't try to be smart and use units, because that's the wrong word. Okay, so far as recommendation concerned, I think that I recommended several times that when you try to put 40 to 60 pounds of nitrogen per acre. And I said that I think some of the early work of putting on as much as 100 pounds may have led to some of the conclusions that they weren't getting benefit, because if this is increasing nitrogen, and once again this is yield, if you had deficiency and put on nitrogen, you might go up like this to a peak response and then go into a decline. That is, you may be over here at this yield, say at 0 pounds of nitrogen, and maybe at 40 to 60 or 40 to 60 or to 70 in here, you may be at your peak yield. But if you go to 100 pounds of nitrogen, maybe you're back to where you've been just as well off not to put on any nitrogen at all because of those ill effects which I just showed you in the slides. If that were the case, and this is partly mostly theoretical, if that were the case, then it might turn out that the data which was obtained in the early trials would indicate a very small response to nitrogen, because you might have many cases where you went over the hill to the toxicity level, to toxicity levels of nitrogen, rather than stopping at the optimum level here, which might be represented more by this range of 40 to 60 pounds. Yes? Well, okay, and that's the next step I'm coming to here. So this then, so far as mature vines are concerned, we would stay on something more like this. Now with something like Tokay or Emperor, in particular Tokay and Emperor, where color might be involved, you might want to go to something like 20 or 40 pounds. I just showed you the effect of low nitrogen on Tokay, so that they have to have good color if they're going to sell it. On the other hand, they feel that they have to have some nitrogen, so a recommendation might be about half what you do on just total production for wine or raisins, or where color is not involved. That's on mature producing vineyards. Now, so far as young vines are concerned, you're more after growth than you are after production, and you're not worried about color. But the only warning I would give you on that deal is that when we say 40 to 60 pounds per acre, we're usually thinking in terms of broadcasting it with a machine that spreads it and broadcasts it more or less uniformly over the whole area. So that when you put on 50 pounds of N, you're putting it on 43,000 so odd square feet, 43,500 and so on square feet, because you're broadcasting it. But if you're putting it on young vines and putting it on by hand, and you've got these little potted plants that you've paid a dollar for, or maybe 50 cents or so, at the most you're only going to fertilize about 2 feet by 2 feet. And if they're planted 8 by 12, you're really fertilizing 4 feet, 4 square feet out of 96 square feet. Now you go put that 50 pounds of nitrogen into this, this is 1/24th of that, I think. If you put all that 50 pounds of nitrogen into this 4 square feet instead of 96, you're effectively putting on almost 24 times this rate. Do you follow me? So far as the square footage that you're covering with the nitrogen is concerned, you're putting on that at a fantastically high rate. So it depends on whether you're going to broadcast it on this young vineyard that you ask about, or whether you're going to put it on by hand. If you're going to put it on by hand, you certainly want to cut the rate. You want to keep in mind what the square footage is that you're putting it on. Now, this is an extremely important point. A guy lost a lot of money on a nursery over in Sonoma Valley year before last, in his first effort to put in a nursery, because he planted these little plants about three, 4 inches apart, and he put on nitrogen at a pretty high rate. I think he put it on something like 100 pounds per acre, but he put it on by hand right along that little vine row right on top of these plants, and he just about killed them, and then he wanted to know why. And we had to go through a little calculation to show him at the terrific nitrogen rate he was putting on. Sure, you can up it a little bit because they have a more shallow root system, and so on. You can up the rate a little bit over the 50-pound rate, but you've got to keep in mind a little bit of common sense if you're putting it around. Somebody called me up the other day, and he's put these little half-gallon milk cartons, you know, around each vine, and they're 4 inches by 4 inches. And he wanted to put all the nitrogen inside that milk carton. And then he said, well, how much should I put on? I said, gee, you better keep that down to something less than a half an ounce. And he said, a half an ounce? This was ammonium nitrate, which is only a third nitrogen. He said, well, it's hardly worth going out there for. And I said, you put that on, figure out what a half an ounce is on 16 square inches on an acre basis and see how much you're putting on.
Have you ever heard about those tablets they use sometimes?
Yeah, those tablets. Well, everything that they argue that's in favor of tablet is against it. That's that's about what it amounts to. You got a tablet that you're going to. Here comes a root down here. See, and you got this tablet sitting here. This is a tablet of concentrated fertilizer. Anybody who knows anything about botany ought to know what happens when that root contacts that concentrated dose of salt. What happens to it? Curls up and dies. Or it certainly isn't going to continue to grow there. And furthermore, the only thing that we'll get around to this later on, but when you're talking about potassium and phosphorus, the big problem in California is to get them to dissolve fast enough. And their big argument is that this makes them dissolve slowly so that they'll last a long time. And the only thing you really need in the first place is nitrogen. You'd like it to dissolve quickly and get it into the plant before bloom time and then go away. So every argument that they give in favor of these tablets is exactly opposite of what the grapevine would like to have. Okay, now we're talking about that, and that's a good point then. We talked about this rate, so be careful putting on this amount of nitrogen. You certainly want to keep it way down to real small doses for these potted plants. And I would never put it all inside this 4-inch milk carton. I'd spread it in about a 2-foot circle or so around it and put on just about a half an ounce ammonium nitrate would be my best recommendation. And that brings me to these various forms of nitrogen. I said at the beginning of this lecture, and I said I'd repeat it later, that what you want to be sure is that you have the nitrogen in the root zone at the time buds start to swell and grow. And this requires you knowing something about the chemistry of the material that you're putting on. And what are the materials we put on? We've got a number of nitrogen fertilizers we can use in California. We can use ammonia, gas, which is normally written as ammonia like this, and that runs 82% actual nitrogen. We can put on urea, which more or less runs about 45% in. We can put on ammonium nitrate, which runs 33% nitrogen. Or we can put on ammonium sulfate, for those of you who haven't had chemistry, I'll repeat a couple of ammonium sulfate, which runs around 21%. Or you can go to calcium nitrate. Calcium nitrate, which runs about 15%. And there's some other organic materials, formaldehydes, urea formaldehydes, and so on, that could be considered. But these make up about 95 or more percent of the nitrogen fertilizers which might be used on trees or vines in California. Okay, we want the nitrogen in the root zone when the buds begin to swell. And I'm emphasizing this because of an incident that made a big impression on my mind way back early when I started in on this work in California, when I visited a grower about 1 o'clock in the afternoon, and he's feeling very complacent. He said it was just before bud swell time, and he said, "Well, I don't have anything to worry about. I put on ammonium sulfate this morning, and you can see right out there right now, I got the water going, and the ammonia is going to be in the root zone, just like you say, when the buds swell." And he was terribly wrong. Because, you see, he was using ammonium sulfate. So here's the form that he was using. He was using ammonium ion, and it has a positive charge on it. And when you dissolve any of these materials, this one here with ammonia, this one, or this one, put that onto the soil, it's going to stick in the top 3 inches or so of the soil immediately and stay there for a couple of weeks or so before you can move it, no matter how much water you flush through it. So he put on his ammonium sulfate and then put on water, and he'd moved that ammonium ion in maybe 2 or 3 inches. Because, getting back to what I showed you earlier, get back to that little soil particle we're talking about, it has the negative charges on it, this clay particle. And when this ammonium ion contacts that clay particle, it goes zing and fastens on, just like two magnets, a positive and a negative end of two magnets. They go together like that and they stick. And you can't move it no matter how much water you put on, until you leave it there long enough for the soil bacteria to convert this ammonia ion is converted by soil bacteria over to nitrate. Now you got a negative and a negative. If you've ever tried to put the two reverse ends of a magnet together, they practically push you away. So now they don't like each other at all. Now you put the water on and they'll move right down to the root zone. So if you're going to put on, I said you had to know something about the chemistry of what you're putting on. So if you put on ammonium sulfate or ammonium nitrate or ammonia gas, you've got to put it on a couple of weeks before buds swell and a couple of weeks before the irrigation you're going to use to push it down to where the roots are. So if that farmer had just put his fertilizer on that morning and then gone fishing for a couple of weeks, or gone up to Las Vegas and gambled for a couple of weeks and then come back and put on his water, he'd been all right. But he's putting on the water that afternoon, and it was doing him a bit of good to put down his nitrogen, not in the slightest. I tried to work this out on a chart once in a sort of a theoretical basis for some growers in Napa Valley, but I think it would still hold for this, and maybe it'll illustrate to you what I'm trying to say. This was, I say it's a theoretical chart, but I think it illustrates, I think it's valid. If you put on ammonium sulfate, assuming you got a 3-inch rainfall after you put on the water, put on ammonium sulfate, you can assume that every one of the ammonia particles is still in the top 3 inches. If you put on ammonium nitrate, of course, half of it is ammonia and half of it's nitrate. So the ammonia stays in the top 3 inches, and the nitrate will distribute with the water that moves down. If you put on urea, urea is a neutral molecule when you first put it on. It's an organic molecule with no charge on it at all when you first put it on. So if you put it on this morning and it rained this afternoon, or this example I was giving you, this grower, turned on your water this afternoon, it would start to move down just like a nitrate particle perhaps. But every time one of these molecules runs into some urease, which is present in the soil, an enzyme that's in the soil, it converts it immediately to ammonium ion, ammonium carbonate, to be exact. And this, once again, has got positive charge on it. So in the moment it converts it to ammonium carbonate, wham, wherever the soil particle is, where it is converted, it's attached to that soil particle. But so if you put on urea this morning and just wait for the winter rains, which may not come for another week or so. By that time, most of that urea has probably been converted to ammonium carbonate already. And then you put on the water and you're treating it just the same as though you put on ammonium sulfate. In fact, in some cases in the South San Joaquin Valley where you have some high pH soils, it might be worse than that because you get ammonium carbonate, and in our high pH soils, you might even get a loss of ammonia from the surface. Or you can put on calcium nitrate here, and then if you've got the water, of course, all of it, nitrogen in the form of nitrate, and it'll just all move down with it. So these are some of the things you have to keep in mind when you're considering the thing that I've repeated so many times, that you have to have the nitrogen in the root zone at bud swell or before this rapid period of growth begins. You can use any of these materials so long as you know what you're doing. Suppose you really did feel that you had a terrific nitrogen deficiency problem and the buds were already swelling and you hadn't done anything about it, you might go out and put on calcium nitrate. But calcium nitrate over the past 10 years has averaged about 25% higher per pound of nitrogen that's contained in it than any of these other materials. Nitrogen gas has generally been the cheapest, and then these three have been competitive. And somebody asked me the other day what they were, and I told them that the fertilizer industry doesn't like university professors getting involved in prices. And I told them, well, if I teach the course, I should know something about the prices. So over the past years, these have averaged about 15 cents a pound, 15 cents per pound of nitrogen, actual nitrogen. Whereas calcium nitrate has been about 20 cents, and ammonia gas, depending on what sort of bargain you could work out, have been anywhere from low of around 9 cents up to around 10 or 12 cents. And on sandy soils in the San Joaquin Valley, this is a pretty good material because you can have it contractor injected, and they have their equipment and all worked out so that they can calibrate it and put it on just at a very fine amount.
Yes, Mark? Is there any difference in the, what you call, facility and utilization of the different ions, the ammonium ion and the nitrate ion?
Not that we know, once you, if you take care of this timing bit.
Just got to say that we just purchased some, Target just purchased some ammonium sulfate at Orchard Supply.
Yeah.
It's $4 for 80 pound bag.
$4 and 80 pounds, so that's $4 for, well, it's 21%, so it's about 16 pounds. $4, so it's $4 for 16, $1 for 4, so it's 25 cents a pound. Well, it's gone up, but of course, he's buying only a few. They should give us a better break than that. Well, the reason I say that, you could buy it at Pay and Save Saturday at 20 pounds for a dollar, which is the same rate, in a 20-pound bag. I know, because I saw it in the ads. 20-pound bag for 99 cents. But that has gone up because Pay and Save's usual bargain price for ammonium sulfate has been something like 69 cents for 20 pounds. So it not only is going up, it's getting more scarce. So you have to hunt for what, you have to take what you can get and increase the cost by another, make this certainly 20 cents a pound. I can hardly believe that on big tonnages you couldn't get it for 20 cents. But the reason these fertilizer salesmen didn't want me to talk about prices, whether you know it or not, in this fertilizer industry, it's all based on a bargaining deal between you and me, and between you and me. And instead of just setting a flat price, it depends on how much you want to buy, when you want it delivered, whether you're going to buy it next year. All these things come into bargaining out the price. So they didn't want to set a definite price. Okay, it seemed to me there's something else I wanted to mention about this, but I don't know what it was at the moment. The only other thing I would say here, which a question has come up a time or two in some of the bull sessions among those of us who work on fertilizer, is that we sort of have a feeling that even though you work out a good deal on one of these materials, that it's not a good idea to stay with the same material year after year after year after year on your own place. That it's good to shop around each year and get the cheapest material per pound of nitrogen you can buy, but every now and then give a little bit and maybe try some of the other materials. For example, down in the Merced area, and north of Merced, and more or less in that area north of Merced there where they grow a lot of peaches on some rather sandy soil. For years and years and years, they used ammonium sulfate on peaches. And this was 100 pounds per acre nitrogen rate, the old standby is telling you about. But ammonium sulfate has an acidifying action on the soil, which in general you would like to have under a California vineyard condition, because most of our California soils tend to be alkaline. So, but this is very sandy soil, very lightly buffered and so on, so that they've used 100 pounds of nitrogen there per acre for so many years in the form of ammonium sulfate that they have acidified their soils, especially in the subsoils around 3, 4, and 5 foot depths. They have acidified the soil so much that they've run into toxicity problems of excess manganese, which you can get under high acid conditions. And what else, we don't know. This is one thing we do know, but we do know that they run into declining productions of peach orchards within that area, and the subsoils are acid, and they've gotten that way, we assume, mostly from putting on ammonium sulfate. So it'd be good if they go and put on some calcium nitrate or ammonium nitrate, which is more or less neutral, in order to, or is neutral, to avoid that buildup of high acidity. Of course, with grapes, with 50 or 60 pounds per acre, it takes you twice as long to build it up, and you may not live that long to worry about the acid soils. But the general rule has been to shop among these materials for the cheapest material you can get, knowing something about how they operate, and then to occasionally change over to some other type. Remember also, what you ought to see obviously here is that this is ammonium nitrate, and if you're putting it on young vines, that I would normally recommend ammonium nitrate, because you put it on this morning, that half an ounce or so per vine, and then turn on your sprinklers or irrigate, and only one half of it goes down. The nitrate part will go down immediately. And then the ammonia won't go down until the next time you irrigate. So you get a split application by going through the vineyard one time. One other point, and then in the coastal counties where you have up and down vineyards and sometimes closely spaced and difficult to get in because of rainy weather and muddy soils, it might be good to think about urea, where you can carry on the most nitrogen with the least weight. You can hardly put ammonia gas on most of these northern soils because they're so heavy and cloddy and hard to get into, and rocks and so on. That's mainly a San Joaquin sandy soil situation. But in the coastal counties, I'd stay with urea or ammonium nitrate. This giving you a split application, and this more or less perhaps giving you a split application. But in each case, they're high nitrogen types, which means that you have the least weight to worry about in order to get on some nitrogen on your vineyards. Okay, that's all I'm going to talk about, except unless you have some questions.
Does calcium have any side effects on the soil too?
Well, of course it does. Remember that clay particle I drew a while ago in which you have sodium and so on, so in which sometimes we put on gypsum to knock the sodium off. But of course this calcium here, of course, still has that positive ion. If you've got that clay particle with the big sodium sitting out here, remember, with its big shell of water, you can knock that single valence sodium off and replace it with a calcium. Maybe this is worth just a moment here to show you, because some people don't seem to get this idea of how gypsum works. You see, just like these two magnets, the strength with which these two magnets are pulled together depends on how far apart they are, obviously, plus the strength of the magnet. Now, if you've got sodium with a great big shell of water around it, the charge is from here all the way down to here, so they're separated quite a ways, and you only have one half the charge. Whereas calcium, having a smaller shell of water, is closer to it, and has double the charge. So that if you put gypsum or calcium nitrate on, and it comes close to a soil particle, this soil particle has so many negative charges, and they're all taken care of, but this calcium can come in and nudge that sodium aside and say, get out of the way. And then if you've got water to wash the sodium out, then you can take care of these alkali soils. But it doesn't help much in most cases, to put on gypsum to take care of a high sodium problem, unless you've got some place for the leaching water to go. You can't just keep it in the bathtub. Yeah, so either that or you've got to have good deep soil. But if you've got a hard pan or some problem of high water table already or something like that, putting on gypsum doesn't help you much because you're not helping the sodium problem unless you can kick the sodium out of sight. And it has to be able to go somewhere. But this is the chemistry involved.
Would the SO4 in gypsum do the same thing that the SO4 does in that ammonium there?
Sure, yeah.
So
yeah.
The calcium nitrate would be better to use than a gypsum if you had an acid.
Yeah, except that calcium nitrate, of course, if this is now 20 or 25 cents, this is probably up to 25 or 30 cents, whereas gypsum is, who knows what gypsum costs, do you? It must be $25 a ton or something because it's mined roughly in the coastal range. It's a very coarse, crude type. And it's $25 or $30 a ton, I'm sure, but I'm not sure, but I would guess. So for that purpose of taking care of sodium, this is a pretty expensive way to do it. But this has been one of the arguments used, that you use calcium nitrate, and it does just the sort of thing you're thinking about. It does two things at once, but it's a pretty expensive way to do the two things at once. Okay, that's all for today, okay?